Okay. Hi guys, today we are going to look at intermediate code generation. Then we will be looking at what is intermediate code generation, types of intermediate code generation, machine dependent intermediate code generation, source language dependent or machine independent intermediate code generation, and the representation of intermediate code or three address code, quad triple, triples and syntax tree, postfix notation, and one more is indirect triple. These are all the topics we are going to discuss. What is indirect triple is, here we will be using a pointer kind of representation, address references. With the triples we will use without addresses. Location references is used in indirect, value references are used in triples. That is the only difference. Let us see one by one. Almost I can say these all are example for intermediate code representations. First we need to understand what is intermediate code. Then what are all the types of intermediate code representation? These are all the types. Actually, syntax directed translation, which we have discussed yesterday, is a predecessor. Predecessor means the previous phase of intermediate code generation. So subsequent to the syntax directed translation, still we need to discuss a lot with respect to syntactic directed translation. Maybe two more hours I would be taking to complete unit number 4. So by that time I will be addressing much more. Now try to understand this with the previous knowledge of yesterday's discussion. Intermediate semantic directed translation is what? It's a CFG plus semantic notations, semantic attributes, semantic representations, or set of rules, a code. See, CFG, machine cannot understand. We, the human, of understanding what is the meaning of each and every production, what is the use of the complete CFG. These are all the sort of things we know. But the computer, how we need to make it to understand? Again, in simple term, SDT is the equivalent to coding. In any language, you may write a compiler. You may prefer to write a compiler using tools like Lexi, Yawk, these kind of way you can write a compiler. There are several languages. The compiler is written with C. If you look at Julia, Python, how the internal mechanism of that language's work is, internally, the underlying bed is C only. They have implemented those kind of packages and entire compiler based on C language. Most of the languages built using C only. Then what is the meaning of SDT is, you may need to convert CFG in terms of coding notation. You need to write a coding. You need to make machine to understand, machine to read, machine to work on the dictations. That is called syntactic directed translation in simple terms of understanding. No need to become compiler design technical aspect. A simple term is translation of CFG to the coding representation. Finally, you need to make the machine to understand the CFG. That way of writing is termed as syntactic directed translation, nothing more. So after syntactic directed translation, or it will go parallelly sometime. We cannot expect phases to work independently. Sometimes there are phases will work dependently or close to each other. Among all the phases, lexical phase and syntactic phases will work close to each other. Whereas semantic analyzer and intermediate code generator will work closely each other. Similarly, code optimization and code generation will work close to each other. This is how it will work internally. So highly dependent. Of course, every phases are dependent to each other, but highly dependent are working in parallel or working cohesively. These are all the phases will work. Whereas when it comes to here, these are all the two phases will work cohesively. Number one is semantic analyzer. Number two is intermediate code generator. So with that note, let me start. This source code directly can be converted into target code. It is possible. We can write a code in such a way that we can write a compiler, then what is the need of intermediate code? You no need to understand how it is available. You understand somehow like this, something intermediate representation between these two is termed as intermediate code. Now the question is, you can use a chat window. Why intermediate code is required? Modern or advanced techniques have arrived. We can directly convert source language to target code. It is possible. But why we are going for intermediate code representation? Any kind of intuitive thought if you have, you can either unmute yourself or you can communicate in the chat window. Why do we go for intermediate code representation? It is possible. Source to target conversion is possible. Then why we need to go for intermediate code representation? Let me wait for your answer. Come on guys, anyone can respond as per attendees. C1, are you there? C2, C5, C6, C7, no one is there. What necessary to go for intermediate code representation? No one is there. Lateral entry, 17, 16, 14, 13. Any one of you can answer for this question. Yeah, someone text in the comment box. Let me check it. It can be used in any compiler. Very good. G2. This is one kind of representation or one kind of answer. I come out with the other notion. If you look at, if you develop a compiler for a language, that language or the compiler, both are interchangeable to same. If you say C languages, you are mean to say compiler only. If you say Java language means you mean to say Java compiler or interpreter only. So what is the meaning is, and every year, if you notice, revolution is happening in the machine. You used to say Intel Core 3, Intel Core 4, Intel Core 5, Core 7. So these are all are different other mechanism. Motorola company processors are available. Intel company processors are available. Several processors are available. So there are several machine architecture also available. The availability of instructions, availability of registers, availability of memory locations. If you consider all those, machine is varying from year to year. Year to year, I mean to say. Then otherwise, each and every processor vary from each other. There are several companies or amoebas. There are several people or several corporates are working for this processor manufacturing. So every processor, the way in which designing instruction set, address points, that 32-bit address, 64-bit address configuration you used to say. So that is address point. The memory capacity is decided by that bit addresses, 32-bit address, 64-bit address. The more and more the bit address representation, more and more the memory capacity, fastest access will be available. 32-bit, you imagine 32-bit and 64-bit, which one is higher performing? Naturally, 64-bit. Now, what is the question is, most of the time, this configuration keep on changing, but the language should work for all the configurations. So, if you directly convert this high-level language to machine-level language, the moment the configuration changes, this compiler developer need to work with this change as well. Then it will be very mess up. Every one of you will tend to buy different laptops. Every one of you tend to buy different processor. Then I am the course compiler developer. What I need to struggle for every variety, I need to sit and write the compiler. It is cumbersome task. Writing is also cumbersome. Users also, it is very tough to download, tough to purchase that compiler, tough to promote that compiler if it is an entrepreneurial aspect. So that what they are doing, they will be converting into intermediate code generation. That processor, depending upon that architecture and specifications, this intermediate code alone will get changed to the machine code representation. This is one aspect. Only the last half, the need of change need to be taken care. This is one. What is another aspect? Suppose you used to look at Python 3.3, then Python 3.9. We have reached up to 3.9. So how this all versions comes together? So if you are not writing intermediate code representation, what will happen? Entire compiler you need to keep changing. Instead, any packages you want to remove or you want to include or you want to update or you want to bring new functionalities, then you can work with before that intermediate code generation alone. Then everything else will become same. So this is the meaning. In single sentence, G2 may be specifying that it can be used in any compiler. That is, in terms of it can be used in the upgradation, I mean to say that you need to synthesize in these two perspectives. You can upgrade any packages, any functionalities, any features into that language without drilling down to that compiler to the fullest. That is the first advantage. What is the second advantage is, you no need to, or the compiler developer no need to worry about the machine architecture, how it is upgraded, how it is changed, so that they are preferring intermediate code generation. That's it. So this is the answer or justification why we need to study, why we are going for intermediate code generation. This is given here, you can look at later on. Now there are two way intermediate code representation. This is two different way we can go for intermediate code representation. One is high level intermediate code representation. Another one is low level intermediate code representation. What that signifies, that name itself you can able to interpret. What is high level is that intermediate code generation is friendly with high level, flexible with high level. It is not flexible with machine architecture. So the moment you keep changing the coding, that Python versions, automatically that intermediate code will correspond or adjust to that, all the features inclusions or features removal, that kind of adaptation is possible. That is what high level intermediate code representation. What is low level intermediate code representation is, it is adaptable to the machine architecture changes. So you decide, for example, the moment you release, when the Python is released by Gudo Wansum, he would have done with the high level intermediate code friendliness. Why? Because lot of changes happened after his first release. It is an open source community, people are contributing. There are several members started contributing to the compiler. Even I am working with one of the students, shortly, maybe in 3 months, we will be releasing the package for the Python, new packages for new functionalities. So that flexibility is possible with Python. Why? Because is that intermediate code generation is flexible to the high level language. There are other way. If you consider Java and C language, almost whatever is possible, that is highly related to machine level intermediate code generation. So that is flexible to the machine. High level language, they need to work a lot for refinement or version upgradation. Whereas those two languages closely work with machine dependent. These all the focus, how that compiler developer focuses and thinking the strategy and developing the design approaches, design strategies, that is the difference, nothing more. So we cannot become flexible for both end, never it is possible. Compromise, it is a trade-off, compromise. Either one you can retain, another end you need to go for putting your effort. However, intermediate code helps in certain aspect, no? Now you agree, either one part of the compiler, no need to disturb. If it is high level, adaptable intermediate code generation. If it is low level IR, you need to work here. You no need to work in this portion. So this is the two different types of intermediate code generation. When you look at this example, low level IR, this Python is the best example for high level IR, I can assure. So Python is best example, Julia is the best example for high level IR. When it comes low level IR, the best example interpreter or the language is Java. Java generates the output after the compilation in terms of bytecode. That bytecode, no need of machine dependent. They are providing the concept called Java Virtual Machine. So the bytecode after Java C, after compilation, it will give you Java classes with a dot class extension. So using that, what it does, that bytecode is your intermediate code generation when it comes Java language. So that bytecode is given to Java Virtual Machine. So that will translate it into high level language. Low level language, machine readable language. But Java Virtual Machine, it's a unit. So what is that unit role is? Java C or that bytecode, whatever it is available, that bytecode is the best example for intermediate code generation. After C language compilation, Java language compilation, Java program compilation using Java C, whatever the output comes, that is exactly called as bytecode technically. When it comes to compiler design perspective, that bytecode is intermediate code. That intermediate code is given, fed as input to the Java Virtual Machine. Java Virtual Machine will give you the machine code. So this is how it works. So Java is the best language example for machine dependent or machine friendly language. So this is the final conclusion. Now, next question, see, what is the role of, look at here. Below are the example for Java bytecode instructions. How this bytecode instruction, Java source code can be run on a Java virtual machine. Output would be your bytecode. How it does is new of create object, a load, load reference, e store, I store, store integer value. Then L add, add long value, swap, swap two values, a return, return value from a function. So these are all the way it is given as the bytecode representation or intermediate code representation. How these codes are fed to virtual Java virtual machine. So that will closely work with or quickly translate it into machine code representation. It's very much easier. That is why Java is machine dependent architecture language. So now let us come to the last point. Bytecode files such as java.class files are most often generated from the source code using compiler like Java C. Now, next question. Normally, there is a subject called system software, and microprocessor. These are the subject not available in your curriculum. So not required to study also, but you should have the awareness. So most of the time, assembly language, the olden day, very long back, I mean to say 32-33 decades ago, assembly code is the only way to code, only way to implement any kind of project, only way to achieve something to be computable. So those days assembly code was working more. Recent days, so we have reached to the level of high level language with a lot of flavors also available. So that what is the meaning is assembly language, if at all you are versatile, closely it will resemble like the assembly language. Bytecode is similar to assembly language. That's all. So that assembly code, if at all you are familiar, several times even I was quoting, the last class also I was quoting the assembly code. Now also we are going to see within the compiler itself one or two samples. That's all. The primary difference between the two different code is bytecode is generated for a virtual machine while assembly code is generated for the hardware. See, look at here. Directly assembly code is converted to hardware. Whereas here bytecode is targeted for only the virtual machine. Then virtual machine output input is given to or output of this virtual machine would become machine code. So it has one intermediate step. So this is the only difference, primary difference between bytecode and assembly code, but more or less these two would become the same, bytecode and assembly code. Now let us get into the today's topic of discussion. So for now, these are all the foundation you should have in order to understand how each compiler is executed and what are all the types of languages available or compilers, how it is working, whether it is closely working with source language or it is closely working with machine architecture. Every compiler is favor of the source language either, or it is favor of the machine architecture. Now let us move on to different types of intermediate code. Three address code, quadruples, triples, indirect triples, postfix notation, abstract syntax tree, otherwise called, these all variant, these all slightly will vary from each other. We will come to know what is the difference. Now I am giving one new introduction or new terminology called abstract syntax tree. Let us see what it is. Nothing to worry about. It is variant of parse tree syntax tree. Assuming that you know these all already, I'll be focusing on this today. So three address code, this only I touched upon in the previous class. Just previous class I said, what are the role of semantic actions or SDT. So one of the SDT role is three address code representation, I said. Now that we are going to look at in detail, consider this is the expression given by the user. C language itself you can consider. This is high level language. A programmer tend to write a program or coding like this. A is equal to B plus C into D. How this is represented into three address code or intermediate code? That is what our discussion. Now what is happening is this R1 stands for register 1. Let us consider what is register. In the previous sessions also several times in the past 3 years, most of you would have seen my articulation. Every machine has several registers. Registers only can closely work or communicate with the CPU. Among the entire computer peripherals or the computer components, CPU is a super fast executor. CPU is the highest speedy component of the computer. When it comes to CPU communication, memory only closely works. Without memory, CPU cannot store anything. CPU cannot able to get anything. Memory again consists of code memory and another one is data memory. So these are all the two types of memory available. Code memory available or code memory is filled with instructions, set of possible instructions specified by the programmer. Data is all the necessary data. It could be a constant, it could be a variable, or it could be any data type, integer, image data, any data. Without data, there is no use of working. We cannot work anything right now. This is the way it works. Now coming to the next point, when it comes memory, it is divided into cache memory, RAM memory, ROM memory, and secondary memory. These are all the possible memory. Beyond that, buffer. These are all the possible memories. According to the speed of the memory or access, I am representing here. The speed of the memory, the accessing speed is highest for buffer. Accessing speed is next to the buffer is cache memory. Next to the cache memory, ROM memory. Next to the ROM memory, RAM memory. Next to the RAM memory, secondary memory. Next to the secondary memory, all the external memory. Whatever that hard disk, pen drive, whatever the external memory you are bringing, CD, these all are, those days we used to do floppy disk, and whatever you externally fit into the computer, that is external memory. So this is the way. Although I say buffer is the highest speedy memory access, buffer also not in the position to communicate with the CPU. That much rapid speed it will work. Then who can communicate? Register. Register is the only, this is also a tiny memory. It is called tiny buffer. We can say it is a tiny buffer. What is register? It is made up of flip-flops. Flip-flops are the basic unit for the registers. Flip-flops finally are the highest speedy 1-bit memory. This is collection of flip-flops, then collection of registers are buffer, then different flavor comes. These are all into different combination. Flip-flops are the basic building block. So when it comes this, flip-flops becomes very tiny. So it is not possible to make to communicate with CPU. When it comes buffer, it is too bigger. It is not possible to communicate with the CPU. So that the communication medium or memory is register. This is volatile memory. Register is one of the volatile memory. Register only can communicate closely with the CPU. So that all the data or correspondence communication can go to CPU only via register. There is no other method to communicate to the CPU. For example, if you want to meet Prime Minister, you can't go and meet directly. Since you are citizen of India, none of us, we have the rights. So we need to approach the appropriate person who is closely working with the Prime Minister so that we can communicate. In that way, register is the only person can communicate with the CPU internally within the computer. No other person can communicate. It is not possible at all. So that all the data, whatever we want to do, we need to keep it in register. Only then computation is possible. So look at C into D. We are writing, roughly only we are writing. For the human perspective, internal mechanism I have articulated. Now we are going for understanding what is the role of this intermediate code generation. It has two different operations. Two different operations computer cannot perform at a time. So that we need to synthesize. This is what I have written a lengthy expression yesterday. Look at here. So R1 is equal to C into D. We are decomposing depending upon the priority operator precedence or priority. Next, after this evaluation, the results are kept in the R1. R1 is given here. B plus R1, result is gone to R2, then R2, R2 to A. Now your question, C and D, where it is available? C and D are available in the symbol table. Symbol table is like a, it is a kind of system software, or it is a kind of data structure. So you can use any kind of data structure and you can design this symbol table, that's all. So from this data structure, you are doing the calculation, or you can feed to register. Before even this, any one of the data need to be loaded into register first. Only then it is possible to do. Let it be for human understanding. This is sufficient. This is a given user program code that is synthesized into these many level. I can say this is very minimal level of representation. Still more better, we need to synthesize into several level. You may write to a small instruction only. You won't be surprised what I have written. We are talking this much, you can ask, but this is how it works. So internally, it needs to be instructed with one operation. It is not like a human to instruct with several operations. Load, add, store, multiply, square root. One only we can talk. You may comprise several operations into a single statement. Machine cannot understand. We need to synthesize. That is called intermediate. If you're able to understand what I'm telling, that's all. You may write simply for I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 10, I plus plus. You will say this is funny statement. First year itself, we know. You can say, but internally compiler is synthesizing into several instruction. High level language, it seems to be after all a for statement. Internally, it will be this much bigger code. It will be written with a minimum of 10 instruction. So continuation, go to that reference point, then do, then from that load, then conditional verification, loading the initial expression, terminal conditional expression or conditional value, then incremental expression, all together, it will take minimum of 10 instruction, I mean to say, minimum of, I'm telling, note the point, you are writing only one for statement. When it comes intermediate code generation or machine execution, machine code, whatever, these all will become larger, but the way in which it executes are rapid speed execution is happening. Millisecond, nanosecond, picosecond only it will execute. So that you are one, every instruction fed fast and taken the output first, fed first, taken the output first. So that is how your compiler or computer machine works. That's all. This is what called three address code representation. Let us go for quadruple representation. This is another method. Again, here data structure helps or plays a role in which it will be represented into four component. What are all the four component is operator. Most of the time we will be working with binary operator. Even if you work with unary operator, one of the argument you leave as a empty cell. That's all. Argument one, argument two, or else you can call it as operand. What is operand? The variable which you give is operand. Then operand two, result. Where you want to keep the result? You may prefer to keep the result in the register, or you may prefer to keep the result in the symbol table. Choice is yours, but this is how it is represented. Quadruple representation will be like this. Let us see this. Yeah, for the same code only quadruple representation is given below. Look at here. A is equal to B plus C star D. First operation is happening with C star D. Result is kept it in R1. Second operation is happening with B and R1. The operation is addition. It is kept it in the register R2. Last operation is R2 plus R1. Doing the result, both results into R1 and R2, kept it in R3. Finally, R3 is assigned here. Somehow, we are bringing this quadruple. This structure only you may need to remember, that's all. Operand, operator, operand 1, operand 2. We need to synthesize it into binary operations, every tiny binary operations. Then how do we represent the result is the main claim. The results can be kept it in either the register or it can be kept it in the symbol table directly. That's all. This is the ultimate inference you need to take from the quadruples, nothing more. Let us come to triples representation. What is finally, see, look at sub-expressions. You are doing sub-expressions. Nothing more is a great concept. It's, if you look at triples representation, is elegant form of quadruples. Quad means what? Etymology. Quad is four. Etymology of the word says quad is four. That's all. Triples means, look at here, operator, argument one, argument two. What is the meaning is, it needs to refer this cell. That is the meaning. So this is represented in the subsequent sessions. We will be discussing how it is possible to evaluate this triplet code. It is possible to evaluate using directed acyclic graph or syntax tree. Forthcoming sessions, we will be discussing about this in detail. What is DAG? Right now, it is sufficient. Triples represent. Using this, it is possible to implement, or it is possible to make it the machine executable form using this triples. Triples has only three component except this. That is the only thing you need to remember. Quadruples, you will be having one more component, that is a result. You will not have that result component. It's a simple to understand. Next, indirect triple. What is the meaning is, in order to make this representation to be executable, you are dependent on one more concept called DAG. Directed acyclic graph. In order to build this directed acyclic graph, you are in need of syntax tree. These are all the complication or intricacies. Now, when it comes indirect triple, what is happening is pointers are given, references to the what the cell or where, which memory location needs to refer for further computation. See, it uses pointers instead of position to store the result. Neither it is a symbol table nor it is a register. It is going to become finally address of the position to store the result. So that is what the meaning of indirect triple. Whenever you see in the computer science the word indirected addresses or indirect, immediately the pointer concept. A pointer means memory location. Addressing the memory location concept will come into the picture. That is indirect triples. Now let us move on to the two more representation. Very short. This is the easiest topic I can say. Postfix notation. Yesterday only I started or ended the session with the postfix notation. So let us imagine there is expression 1 operator, expression 2 parenthesized expression id. So this is a semantic rule. Every non-terminal need to be attached with an attribute. That is called semantic rule, nothing more. So this associated programming fragment is print output. What it is doing? E1 code with operation or with a specified operator. This operator can be anything. Then E1 code is E1 code. There is no more change here. It is a simple value. LHS is given to, RHS is given to LHS. Next is E code dot, here even we can write dot L value, lex value. So this ID is obtained from lexical analyzer that is given to E code. Yesterday we have seen instead of ID, num. Today we are seeing ID, that is the only difference. This is called postfix notation. So how it needs to be converted into postfix? Look at print ID. Yesterday we have seen the infix to postfix notation. If you are flexible with that discussion, that itself you can use. Finally, this is one way of intermediate code representation. There is another way, or this is the last method I am going to discuss today. Parse tree or syntax tree or abstract directed translation. Let us imagine the same evaluation grammar. E produces E plus T, E produces T. Yesterday we discussed the equivalent grammar for this. Same only I'm discussing here. For that, given CFG, this is a tree, the final syntax tree or parse tree. Look at now, for this input string, if you are expected to build the parse tree, how you can do? This is the way you can do. ID star ID, ID plus ID. What is the final meaning here is, this is to be reduced. Since this is parse tree, this is syntax tree. Finally, suitable to the user code. This is grammar. Entire grammar is represented in terms of parse tree. So the given input string is represented in terms of syntax tree. This is the translated version of parse tree to syntax tree. Now let us see one more method, abstract syntax tree representation. What does it mean? Finally, you would have seen in your data structure, node representation in a tree. Every node you need to represent with expression evaluation tree or infix to postfix evaluation using tree traversal. If you would have done, you will be understanding. So the primary partition of that node would become operator, rest all would become your operands. So this is the way internally how it is finally represented for the evaluation of the expression can be termed as abstract syntax tree. That's all. So the node representation here, we don't go for the internal representation. These all a periphery level of representation. How exactly the linked list is used for tree representation. Every linked list component we need to specify. So the first partition or first field of the node would become operator. Next field of the node would become operand. Another field of the node would become operand, because this is also operand only, or this is also a value, but it is indirect. It is dependent on this node. This node is doing the computation on multiplication, dependent on this operand, dependent on this operand. If it is unary operator, you will keep operator here, you will keep only one operand, other field would become null. So that signifies unary operator. This is how abstract syntax tree is represented. With that note, today I'm concluding. Let us continue in the forthcoming session.